We didn't get that, Jacopo. Hello, the recording is in progress, but now we have to put on the good face because other people will see this in the future. It will go in the annals of possibility management and Rage Club spaceholder training. And today, Clinton was willing and voluntarily actually offered his presence for our last session for at least a little while, an hour and a half, to deepen the context and take you through your liquid state that I can't, or that other people can't, because Clinton has this specialty. And so here it is. Thank you, Clinton, for coming.
Well, welcome. Some of you I've got to hang out with this summer and co-create spaces, and some of you I seem to have never hardly even met before. And what I understand, though, is that you have something in common, which is an adventure spirit. You have some kind of drive to bring aliveness to other people. And I am just enthusiastic about your drive, your commitment about bringing aliveness to other people. Because I remember back in my early days, never having encountered pure rage before. This would be back in 1991. And in a training space, I could see other people shift into pure rage, but I could not do it. And I was the space holder. And so it was a shock. My whole world vaporized during certain trainings where step by step during the trainings where I could actually get in touch with this experience in my bodies, this experience of God, I'm actually angry. And it's okay to be angry because the anger has use, has direction, has force and intelligence. And I was so shocked by that because by then I was already a college graduate. I had a degree in physics. I owned a house and a car and had a wife and two kids and had built a house, a passive solar rammed earth house in Arizona. And I thought I was an adult. And this was such a shock to go back to the beginning of encountering, hello, welcome to planet Earth. You have four feelings. One of them is anger. And it was just a, I look back on it now and it was glorious. I was so glad there was something besides the ordinary, boring culture that I had been born and raised in. And yet it was also scary. Because it was so powerful, and there still back then was not much intelligence about it. So you're still, I think, part of the researchers. You're the res This is not a known territory on planet Earth. So your courage is taking you into unfolding and discovering and laying, building out this place called Archaearchy, where people have four feelings and can use them. And they have emotions and they can unmix them. Et cetera, et cetera. You're building out this territory. So you're pioneers in this domain. And I'm really happy to be amongst so many courageous pioneers and to celebrate what you're doing. How many of you are already delivering Rage Club? How many of you are already doing that? Okay. And how many have a Rage Club planned soon to start delivering Rage Club? Do other people have that? Okay. All right.
Or work talks. Laura, you have an upcoming work talk that would be included in Rage Club.
Have a work talk.
What's the title of the work talk?
Fully unleashed woman.
Okay, that would include some kind of rage, I would think.
Yes, it's a anger space. And
It's a what space?
there will be anger there in that space, yes. And I do have the intention to deliver a rage club later.
How much later? I mean, you know, later is one of those words. It's an American slang word. Later, it could be 50 years later. So, you don't have any boundaries on your later?
Yes, within 1 month.
Ooh, okay, that's pretty soon then. I would say soon. That would be not later, that would be soon. Okay, well, cool. Do you guys feel like a team together?
Yes.
Because Chloe is about to you into a group of 100 and something other people who are delivering Rage Club or have been through Rage Club spaceholder training. And so you're going to be shoved into a bigger team. And it's happened to me a few times. And so I've really loved my little team like this. And then our team gets shoved in with this giant oatmeal bowl pot full of all these other Rage Club spaceholders. And it's like, I don't even know them. We didn't go through these, you know, they didn't give me feedback. They put me in a liquid state, you know, for weeks, and I didn't get to hate them or love them or be jealous of them. Or, you know, it's all these new people. And probably you know some of them and probably you don't know any of them, but I would really encourage you to mix yourself in well. And the best way to mix yourself in well is to go through what we call a crack in certainty. Have you talked about that, Chloe, in terms of setting up a Rage Club space? It's an important distinction in terms of holding transformational space. So Rage Club is transformational space. It's in alignment with people's evolutionary path. It unfolds potentials that they have that they probably did not know that they had. And this is powerful stuff. But to hold its space for that, to bring people into that space, it helps to know about what's called crack uncertainty. And I was trying to think if we have a website called that, but I don't think so. Okay. So
no, but there's a website called PM Processes, and there's a list of break uncertainty processes in the PM.
Okay.
PMprocesses.mystrikingly.com.
Okay. It's worth checking the website PM Process, and Chloe said there's this alphabetical by some kind of estimation, and you could go and find break uncertainty. Is it break uncertainty or crack uncertainty? I think it's crack uncertainty.
Maybe, I don't know.
In any case, this stuff is approximate. So, and to find out what it means, and what it means is that people come in with their box, and they come in with their assumptions and expectations and their projections and their fears and their conclusions, and like people just can't help it. We just show up places like that, and especially in a space that's uncertain, like any kind of a rage club is uncertain. People don't, they're going to learn about things that they never heard other people really learning about very much. And so people come into this space pretty well defended. And at the side of their defense is the gremlin. So you have a gremlin and a box all in your room, your space. And the question is how to bring that into a working team suddenly, without spending weeks, you know, meeting after meeting after meeting, slowly getting to know each other. And so what we discovered is if people go into a liquid state together, all of a sudden the box isn't holding together, the gremlin isn't so focused, and it's like you can come together in a team in one crack uncertainty process where people go into a liquid state. One of the fastest, most effective ways to bring people through a crack uncertainty process is to have them give feedback and coaching to each other. Because even if they don't know each other, the people are smart enough. Well, even if you give bad feedback to somebody, let's say they put you in a group of three and you're starting to give somebody feedback and it's off, like completely wrong. Well, you've had that happen to you. You know what it feels like to have people hammering you with feedback that has nothing to do with you. you know, it's their own projection or their own fear or whatever it is. And it's just slamming on you. And you, but you, there's a kind of a, you know, a reaction. There's kind of a defense. You have to do something with this. You have to go, look, that has nothing to do with me. Or, you know, or maybe it does. And you just never saw it before. So that's what this certainty, it cracks the certainty about who you are and what's going on, so that there's space, there's movement. And in that movement, we just connect as a team, because we're all in the same place called liquid state. Whereas before, when people come in, everybody's in their own place called box and gremlin defense strategy. In 20 minutes or something, you have an entirely a team working together who's unleashed their capacity for delivering feedback and coaching to each other. So I encourage you to do that kind of thing at the beginning of any kind of transformational space that you do, like when Ann Chloe and I are going to do expand the box training or lab or work talk or workshop or whatever. The first thing we put on the table is, well, what's the crack and certainty process? How do we want to do this? It's just the first thing. And really, once you have your bright principles in the space and you lay out and you do your crack and certainty process, the thing is flying. The space is flying. And so you won't necessarily know what is going to come next, but you know something will come next because you're flying, because the team is working. People have questions. People have demands. You know, there's things, stuff comes up for people and it rolls out. It rolls. But if you have to go in and start with people's boxes and try to have a conversation and connect, the gremlins are running the show, it's just a mess. So I would encourage you to practice with building, you know, starting spaces, transformational spaces with crack and certainty. Any questions or comments about that?
It's not exactly about this crack and certainty. It's more about, I have a question about how I feel like the spaces that are, it looks to me, the spaces I'm creating are like, there's a gremlin free zone in there. And by that, the people that come to the space, or the gremlins of the people that come to the space, hate the space. And I want to have experiments, or where do I need to put my attention to invite also the gremlins of people to have, like, to get something out of this space?
Yeah, it's a great, I'm glad you're asking that question. Because the idea of having a gremlin-free space would be like having a regenerative culture on planet Earth, with humans under having a regenerative culture. And it's possible to conceive of that, or to envision that, or picture that. And it's your heart might sing about it, you know, and you might relax or feel great about it. And then you go, gosh, let's have a regenerative culture on planet Earth. And you turn on the news or something, and it's just insane war, you know, torture, in what people are doing to each other for no reason other than they have hungry, unconscious gremlins that are wanting a gremlin feeding frenzy. I mean, what is going on between Israel and whatever that other place is
Palestine.
This is gang warfare. It is gang warfare. We're going to hurt your people. You hurt our people. We're going to hurt your people more. You hurt us people back. Burn the city down. Blow up the city. It's an insane gremlin feeding frenzy. And I'm writing a novel now where some of my characters start in Aleppo, which is a city in Syria that not only this year had a 7 on the Richter scale, 2-7 on the Richter scale earthquakes, but the city was already destroyed by gang warfare between these factions, you know, a psychopathic president and the revolutionaries and ISIS, you know, this spiritual gremlins. And you have them all fighting each other, just destroying everything, including these amazing ruins in Palmyra, which is this ancient city there. They just been blowing shit up. So, okay, you can imagine having a gremlin-free space. You've got your golden cube, and you're going to leave the gremlin at the door. And who comes to your space? Nobody. That's a shock. Nobody wants to go in a gremlin-free space because their gremlin won't have any fun because their gremlin's unconscious and needs to have fun. And so I've been working with a different kind of a thing, which is, I'm calling it synthesis right now, but it has to do with holding a different kind of space in which opposing elements are invited. Contradictory, warring elements, hateful, spiteful, resentful elements you've brought together in this space where that's totally needed, because you, as the alchemist, you as the space holder, require bizarre ingredients. You need authentic, real ingredients in order to do the alchemical reaction of evolution. You need those elements. And so if you block them at the door and they can't come in, what you get is a bunch of fake people pretending to be nice people and unable to show up, to be present, to be, you know, to take a risk, to let things fall apart, you know, let something else emerge. They're not able to do that because they're dedicated to this, it's gremlin-free space. And so the gremlin-free space thing is an idea, and it turns out to be pretty fanatical. It's almost a fantasy world. It's that far away from realities that it's really a fantasy world to go, well, I'm holding a gremlin-free space. And you understand it in your mind, but in reality, you don't get the elements that you need to play with, to participate with. If you have a different orientation, if you go in and you're holding this space and you're going, this is a space of possibility for everybody. Bring your gremlin. Bring your mother's gremlin. Bring, you know, your uncle's gremlin. Bring everybody. Bring all your underworld, you know, your ancestors. Bring the dark side. And you're holding this space of bright, you know, love and compassion and possibility and evolution. And you're inviting the creatures. And you invite them in the space with a yes. And every time somebody kind of explodes with this hatred or rage or trying to, you know, a gremlin attack or jokes or whatever, you go, yes, what is that? What is that? We need that. Let it get bigger. Yes. What is that? What's going on really? And this stuff from under the strategy will come out. And the strategy has intelligence. It just wasn't allowed to come out before. And you go, I hate that this is like this. I don't want it to, I want it to be that, you know, and this truth will come out of people. And this is the stuff that can mix in this field that you're holding, this space that you're holding, where it's chaotic. You need these powerful forces to cause the chaos that disorganizes people's defense strategy. It disorganizes stuff. And that it's this liquid state space, which is exactly what you want. When you're holding a space, if it's not liquid, nothing's happening. And so it's about holding. And you get it. Your force, what's actually happening is once you elicit or liberate these forces that are coming, that are represented by the people, once they're in this space, then they're catalytic elements. They're alchemistic elements. They're like, they do things together with each other that you could not possibly do with them. And it's not coming from you. It's coming in, and the space is held. You've got these unlimited resources to support you. You've got bright principles. You've got your archetypal lineage. You've got echo. You've got all these huge forces that are really infinite resources to support you in this. So you can call in more chaos because you don't have to hold it yourself. The space is holding it, and you're holding it. It's like an oven. It's called an athanor, which is an alchemist oven that you put the crucible in so the reaction can take place. So you are the space in which this reaction can take place, and you don't even necessarily figure it out. You don't figure it out. It happens by itself when these elements are liberated and they can synthesize a new evolutionary place for people. So people walk out going, God, what was that? You know, they're so full of energy or full of unpredicted, unexpected stimulation. And but yet they're not hating somebody anymore. Their hatred was wanted. Their total fear was wanted, you know, and it's called through them. And it's like they don't have to carry it as a secret anymore, because in your space, you called it out and put it on the table and mixed it all together. And this part handled this part and added this thing, and you have this next thing. And it's not something that you can design, but you can call it forth. I mean, as a Rage Club space holder, that's what you get to do. That's what you get to do, because you can. So I'm really glad, Kian, that you brought that up, because this thing about having a gremlin-free space is understandable, but it's not very close to reality. And it will block you from having fun, basically. Block you from being able to cause what you want to cause for people, you know, is for their evolution to happen. Because you need the chaos. You need that, and it happens through a synthesis. But you need the chaos to have the synthesis, and the people bring the chaos, and you're the space holder for the chaos and the synthesis. So it's a hot time, you know, it's really a hot time. Stuff's going everywhere. And it takes, you know, you just have to try it for a while before you get it, what I'm saying, like that it works. If at first it'll seem insane, you know, how was your Rage Club? And you go, I don't know. You know, what happened? Well, I don't know. I mean, all this stuff, I don't know, you know, and that's how it will be. And it will start to build something in you for moving up in the game worlds that you can hold space for. So there's big need right now in the world, and getting bigger, for Rage Club space holders to consult other organizations. And so an organization or other game world, there's so many different game worlds out there that don't have the distinctions and can't hold the space that you can already hold, and the distinctions that you already have. And they're longing for that. And so don't be surprised if, because of the legends that you make, somebody, people start calling you up and saying, hey, we got, for example, we just got a call from a large community in Northern Germany saying, we have people with crystallized hardened gremlin attack strategies, and this is a peaceful community, and we need somebody to put them in frying pans and hold these frying pan spaces to crack this open, because we can't do it. We need you guys from Possibility Management, you guys. So don't be surprised when people calling you and saying, can you do this? Just say yes. Don't think, oh God, I don't know how to do this. I never did this before. I'm not a game world consultant. I don't, you know, don't forget it. They called you on purpose. Your legend brought them to you. Just go, yes, just go in and just connect and talk with people. What's going on? As soon as you say what's going on, it'll be clear. Hold the space, let the chaos loose, you know, and hold that kind of a transformational space. And all your Rage Club distinctions will make it happen. Cool. Thank you.
Thank you.
I want to add one thing, which is, it was a huge discovery about, I hate, we did this, I hate in exercise, just saying I hate in the women's lab. And it was finally, it was a good girl busting. It was the way to crack through, trying to shift from, you know, it's a horrible shift to try to be a good girl or a good boy to being responsible, because it seems so close. You know, to be an adult responsible, but I've been a good girl all my life, and that's survival, and that's not, and, you know, and where's the leap? And the leap is really through the underworld. And so for 20 minutes, every woman was shouting, I hate this. And I want, you know, and I want to do this to them. And I want to, you know, twist their head and you know, shit down the hole and never look back and leave them in the dust. And like, finally, you know, finally the real thing was showing up, and to real. And they could experience, God, I'm not a good girl. Like, I have all this stuff going on and part of that is caring. Like, there's part of that that is really caring. And so that was just great. So that was a fantastic exercise, which I will add into the handbook. And And the other part was also, Kian, you can rely on gremlin transformation. So to not do so much gremlin transformation in Rage Club, but if you see somebody who's just complaining, attacking, you say, there's a space, because this is fucking up your life. There's a space for gremlin transformation. You can hold space for the chaos, and you send them to gremlin transformation, and it's up to them if they're going to do it. You can rely on the village, yeah.
Anton, are you in Germany?
I am right now in Mexico, in Chiapas.
Oh, wow. With David?
I'm with Frank, but just 200 kilometers from David.
Okay.
And in La Queche. And I'm in Esperanza.
Ah, okay. Oh, okay. Ah, nice. Okay. Nice that you're here. Are you delivering your Rage Club in English or Spanish?
I would deliver it, I don't know, in both. I could do both.
Yay. just an experience that Anne Chloe and I had in Costa Rica was we were working with a game world there that was asking for some consulting. And so we did 2 days of game world consulting, and they actually had what they're called Ticos, which are the local Costa Ricans, the people who speak Spanish, the workers, right? You know, the local culture. And we had five of them or so in the space. And they were quiet pretty much in the first day, you know, because their boss was there. And they had no idea about this stuff. It was just a weird kind of thing, but they were working in a transformational center. And so there was some attraction that they had that they did not know that they had to transformational spaces. And so by the end of the first morning, they started to talk. They started to ask questions or speak. And it was so fabulous, because with these guys, there's just no bullshit. It's to the point. And you don't have to dance around these fancy personalities, you know, this American marshmallow zone, hoopy poopy lands. Crap, you know, you don't have to deal with all that. You just go simple, so simple, and straight to the point, and spaced, and next question, and take them into the process and coach them, you know, for how to actually give feedback and coaching to each other. By the end of the second day, these guys were on fire, you know. And so I just really encourage you to do it in the local language with the local people as much as you can, because they're loving this stuff. Really, you know, indigenous traditions are powerful in terms of shape-making culture on the people's possibility. And the intention of the ancestors and the intention of the traditions is to keep things the same, because it has worked before. And if you change the tradition, the corn might not grow, nor the house might fall down. And so you want to stick to the tradition and follow, do what the ancestors say, to duplicate what already was working. Well, conditions today are not the same. We have rapidly evolving conditions, politically, financially, weather-wise. You know, the whole world is changing so fast that trying to duplicate what already worked before is a losing strategy. And so there's this, people feel this. People feel like, okay, you know, the ancestors are great, the traditions are great, but and I need something else. I need something more. I need the next thing. And these guys, anyone who will come to your spaces, you know, should really do a lot of work talks. Do a lot of work talks, because this is a low step. You know, it's 5 euros, 10 euros, whatever, you know, for people to come in these spaces and have this conversation and meet new people who want to talk to them about stuff that they're actually interested in that they never knew could be talked about. And so you have lots of work talks, little workshops, and then people will start going, okay, I start to like these people. I start to trust these people. I've been around them. Oh, here's Jose, here's Felipe, here's Pedro, here's Maria. You know, these people that go, oh, really? I'm not the only weird one. I'm not the only strange one. And then we all have the same kind of construct inside. You know, we have a being. that is built, the matrix is built with distinctions, and you just build distinctions in their being. And so, and they're not so, the local people have, I mean, I'm thinking right now about a team of Polish, a couple from Poland who took their young boy to Tonga as an experiment to get out of modern culture and just live in the Tongan village for a while. And they've done super with that. And the people in the Tongan village, they tried to have these conversations with the local people, and the local people could not understand their motivation. They thought, you know, they could understand the motivation of a Christian, you know, missionary who wants to come in and convert them to a religion. So they understood that purpose, but that was not their purpose. They didn't want to convert them to anything. They wouldn't want to take anything from, they wanted to, you know, support possibility between them. And there's just this village mentality, which is far detected as different. If you're detected as different, they will hate you, or they will, you know, put poison or salt on your crops. They, you know, they will do things. They will just attack you for no reason. It's just that you're different. And so it's a big, big fear. It's a controlling thing. So, but when people are in your space and they can say, I'm afraid that my neighbors are going to do this if I show up different, you go, yes, thank you for saying this fear. And then the fear has intelligence. And the only intelligence is not just to be normal all the time and to suppress who you really are, pretend to be somebody else. That's not the only option that your fear is telling you. Well, what else is your fear telling you? So I'm really happy that the Rage Club possibility is spreading into quote unquote indigenous or original cultures more, because it has so many possibilities for them. And we need that possibility liberated through, you know, it's like the carrier wave, the energy that is the rage, is the clarity for rage to hold the new possibilities.
About that, if you have a hint how to introduce the rage work with, for example, local people here in Mexico, and I mean in the whole world, they are living violence every day in the house, so rage in form of violence, so it's like a very dangerous space for them to just even talk. So for me, it was difficult to bring this work with local people here that are very traumatized for violence every day in the house. So my question, if you have possibilities how to open this.
Yeah, you know, it's not just your local indigenous culture doing that. This is cities everywhere. It's everywhere this kind of violence, secret violence is happening, and it's going on. And there's some stuff you're not saying, David. You're not saying that it's mostly the men being violent and the women either violent back to try to protect themselves, but it's mostly the unconscious, uninitiated adolescent boys who are doing it, the gremlin, essentially. Does that resonate with what you're saying?
Yes, yes, totally.
So what you're addressing is patriarchy. You are addressing patriarchy. And what we're discovering is that women build archaearchy. Women are the ones who build archaearchy, not the men. And so your work is going to need to be with the women. And it starts with getting women raging together with no men around. That's the beginning. Because women, you put women together raging with no men around, they will build archaearchy. So, and Chloe discovered this, and with Vera, in this Women of Earth Lab in Portugal, it was 5 days of a miracle. It was 5 days of a whole new platform for possibility management in the world of get women together, let the women rage together, and they will build archaearchy. When there's no men around. And so that's the point right now, is get women together raging with no men around, And then they will build a different culture that's at a different level from where the men are. And the men have nothing with that. And then, so the whole thing is they hold this high bar and the men will go, well, I don't, they want to do their violence. And the woman says, here's the bar. You want to talk to me? Here's the bar. Otherwise, this conversation is over. Here's the bar. You want to relate to me? Here's how we relate. Or this conversation is over. You're not going against anything. It's not the women having to fight or change or educate or heal or transform or go down to the level of the men. That game is over. It's the women building archaearchy. What were you going to say, Clay?
A few things. One is as a men's space holder, you can do this. So this Clinton has held women's lab before because no women were holding women's lab. And so you call the women together, you set the context, and then you leave.
You still hold the space, but
you still hold the space, but you leave the room. Like you leave the room.
I mean, my memory is I was holding a baby and walking around outside while the women were doing the women's lab that I was supposed to be leading. That's how it goes.
So you can do this, you know, as a man. And then there's, you know, the woman will say, well, possibly, you know, if I get really clear, I will get, there will be more violence. Mm. That's the, you know, often the fear from women. I will get more violence. And the reality is not so. The violence come because the woman is hysterical. Because the woman is like this, she's
mixing emotions.
She's mixing emotion, the anger and the fear, but she's also not clear saying, this is my home. This is my, and it's not up for discussion. It is declared so. It is declared so. And so this is what you'd be training the woman in, is to get this inner sense of this is my earth. This is my village. This is my neighborhood. These are my children, all of them. They're my children, and it's my home, my bed, my kitchen, and it goes like this. And very few of the partner men, I think, would be really physically violent. But so there's a way for that is that in the women's lab, we were training self-defense. And that's, you include it as part of Rage Club. So you buy, it's really, we were, Vera and I were training in Krav Maga, which is street fighting. Everything's allowed. There's no technique. There's no method. It's not Aikido or karate or everything's. And the thing is not about learning how to fight. It's learning how to be safe so you can run. So you create damage over there so that you can run and, you know, care for your physical body. But just, and it, the most thing is to have the thing, I can do this. If somebody grabs my hand, if somebody tried to pull me, if somebody put me against the wall, I can get away. And to have that in the body, then the woman can just be there and just relax.
Will you give a link to them for that work?
Yes, the Krav Maga, yes. And so the one we did in Lisbon was so fantastic because we did it with a woman who's the highest graded or whatever in Krav Maga, and she's one of the only women teaching women's classes. So a lot of women, often it's mixed classes, but she does once a month, once a week, only women's space. And it's, so I will give the link and that you can find something like that next to you.
Thank you.
So David, it's a big deal. It's just a big deal. And it isn't hopeless.
Mm-hmm. I mean, can I add, you know, David, for example, you have a place in Enlakesh where women could move into. If they say, you know, I don't want to go back. And you say, fine, we have a place for you. You can come and move here. And that's such a big, you know, such a big key. Or move to La Esperanza, you know, far away from the village, you know, and that's the place where you can start building archaearchy. So you have you have a lot of tools, like you have built a lot of foundation to be able to offer that kind of clarity.
Mm-hmm.
And just keep calling forth the women's rage, because it's all jewels. It's all about, you know, dignity, nobility, you know, integrity, communication, connection, love, planet Earth, you know, family health. You know, it's, this is what the rage is about. And so you just keep getting the, calling the rage forth, and then it'll go, okay. I mean, the best kind of thing is to hold this space where this chaos and this rage is coming out, and you just have people come in rage for 15 or 20 minutes. And then you go, does everybody know what to do now? Because that's what happens. Everybody rages for 20 minutes, a half hour, and then everybody knows what to do. And it's, the meeting's over. You know, and they all know what to do next. And then you come back together again next time. And it's just a fantastic resource to use. And but you need to be a Rage Club space holder to do that.
I have a question. If women are building archaiarchy and support this division on men and women, what would be the men's role in this process?
To take care that the women have everything they need to be there. So I can imagine to cook or to take care of the baby or to clean and do all that stuff that women usually do. Or in so many places in modern culture do.
I hope you also watched the last meeting that we had with the other Rage Club space holders, which was for me last night. But there was a lot about this. We kind of came up with this metaphor, which is when the women turn on, it's like this mechanism shows up, this engine shows up, and the engine is connected to a saw blade, big disc of metal with sharp little things on it, and it's going. You have this saw blade. You've got these women with this amazing color, which is this rage and clarity. And what's the men's job? The men's job is to go bring in the logs. It's just exactly on tone what you said. You go support, you know, you bring in the logs that need to get sliced into boards. And if it turns out that you, as the man, are the next log, then just go for it. You know, let them slice you into boards. Because men cannot do this for you. Men cannot and will not do this for each other. I'm sure you have heard quote unquote men's groups before or men's work before. And men cannot do this for each other. There's a secret defense patriarchy going on. Kind of men's group. And so let the machine slice you into boards so you can go into the next culture. You have some use in the next culture because men's group won't do that for you. Archaearchy is built by women. First, you know, for the first 100 years, it's going to be like that.
Until all men are sliced in boards.
I think you're feeling something right now.
Yeah, I'm feeling something.
What?
I feel fear. I feel fear of the uncertainty of having to enter space where I'm not where I'm not under control, where I don't control the space. Yeah, I had exactly the situation with my mother last night that I didn't see for 2 years. And so I was giving her feedback for that didn't work for me, and I felt her rage, and I just could not hold it. Of course, there was a lot of emotion. It was overwhelming. I just had to leave the room because she would destroy me.
What's wrong with letting her destroy you?
Nothing. And I didn't have the balls to stand it, to just be there and let it hit me. Yeah, it was a defense strategy thing.
Thank you for saying that. Wow. Pablo, you going to say something?
Why is being destroyed okay?
Which burns is not real.
I think I get it.
It's intense. This is what's happening now is intense, but you know, either we do it like this or we go start dropping bunker buster bombs on our neighbors and raping and pillaging like it's going on in Israel and Palestine, Ukraine and Russia and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, all over the planet. Either we do it consciously or it happens unconsciously. This is, you know, the breakdown is going to happen. The breakdown is happening. So either we let it, we do it on purpose, held space, and with good intentions. Or it's going to be a hell world, just blowing. So you get to choose, but you don't get to avoid it.
When we deliver the Rage Club, do we inform what will be destroyed, or we just don't say anything?
Can you? I think you're asking a great question, but it has more to it. Can you just say
yes.
More?
So I'm not always conscious. Your example that being destroyed, the part of which is being destroyed is not real. So do I say to others or to myself, or I bring it up to conscious that this part of me is not real? Or am I just leaving it be for discovering by the people I'm delivering the Rage Club to?
Yeah, thank you. I get your question, I think. It's not going to help people to give them a concept in their mind so they think they can understand this is not real. So therefore you can let it be destroyed. This is not going to help people because it is their identity at the beginning. And it's crazy making for them. You know, you're trying to create a fantasy world generator. Go, this is not real. This is not real. This is not. And really what you want is the opposite. You want a thing that goes, this is real. What is real? You know, this glass is real. Okay, ouch, this is real. And that pain in my finger is real. And that's about it. That's about it for what's real. There is not much else real. And so I don't, it's not about talking about this is not real. What's talking about is to go through the process. Stuff will come up, go, okay, what do you think about this? Stuff comes up, what do you feel about this? Okay, stuff comes up, what can you do with this? Is this useful? No, it's not useful, okay? What was its purpose? Well, survival, revenge, it had this other purpose. And so the point is to keep going into it rather than to try to make it more comfortable or easier. It's not about making it easier. It's not about making it comfortable. You just keep going through it, layer after layer. Take it apart, move it apart. So many parts. Does that help? It's a great question. It's a bigger question than I just spoke to. So I hope you don't lose your question. Keep asking that question as you work with people.
Clinton, or Cahol, can you say the question again? Because the recording, the internet cut, and I want the question in the recording.
I try. So there was this example of Anton's mother that could destroy him stay in his, in her presence. So there was this comment by Clinton that why not?
I said, that which is real does not burn. Yes. That which is real cannot be destroyed.
So I got from this that there.
I'm asking mostly for the question. I got the answer, but I want the question.
Yes. So I don't remember exactly.
So what he said was, when I'm in a space and there's a possibility of something getting destroyed, why not tell people just let it be destroyed because it is not real?
Okay.
And it would be a strategy to make a fantasy world or to make it comfortable or to make it, you know, easier to let it be destroyed because it's not real. But then you set up this whole fantasy world of saying it's not real. And this is the opposite of kind of work we're doing. We're going towards what is real. And so then they only work with when the process is happening is stay in the process. Stay in the process. Really, there's this spiritual teacher named Chogyam Trungpa, and a student asked him, what do you do when you're in hell? You know, like everything is like an underworld, horrible underworld, nothing makes sense, the world's falling apart. And Chogyam Trungpa says, I try to stay there. Just because in the staying there, more gets digested, more gets transformed, more gets integrated, instead of trying to go away from hell and back to the nice world. And I wrote an article, and it's in the No Reason book. And it's several times I wrote in that space where everything was just gone, where there's this crack in certainty so big that my life was gone. And you can track the process of what I'm writing. I was just in the process writing, and I got to this place of, well, how do I stay in the how do I stay in this horrible space? How do I stay in this groundless hatred, confusion, hopelessness? You know, and actually, that's when it kind of wrapped up and finished. Was just trying to stay there, let it finish. But trying to go away from it keeps it going. You get that? That which you resist persists, you know? So trying to stay there, it was gone. So it's not a technique, but it's just about the value of these liquid states, the value of the liquid states. And so, you know, your clients are going to go through this. Your people who come to your rage club, their world will start transforming. And it's your job to be a space holder, not only for rage club, but for basically their path. You know, they're part of the path when they're with you on the path right there. You're a team. You're with them in the team. And so people will come to you with exactly these questions, the same kind of questions. So I really appreciate the reality of the examples that we're putting on the table here and the questions about them, because your job will be to answer those questions for people and go, yeah, you will feel like you're going crazy because the world that you thought was real is turning into cotton candy. It's just turning into fluff, turning into smoke. It's just nothing. You go, and I thought it was real. I thought it was true my whole life. My parents thought, the advertisers, the companies, like everybody thinks it's real. And it's just like, just dust in the air. And what do I do now? And you just, would you just say, well, have a cup of coffee, you know, let's be together. We're going to be right there in that nothing together. Yeah. Kian, were you going to say something?
Yeah. I just
go ahead.
Took a moment to let this nothingness hit me also. Thank you. I'm one of those men who holds space for Men's Circle at the moment. And I get it. I like Well, I partially get it. So this is why I'm speaking. And I'm getting that it needs, like, when I'm working with those men, basically what a part of me wants to do is just scream at them until this shell cracks that most men live in. And I do it also. I scream at them if there's the door for that open. And also I get that I or all of us men need to die to basically to all what we think we were, because or like to the whole culture of patriarchy, because it's built on the shadow. Like basic patriarchy is the masculine shadow running the show. And so basically everything we are or think we are needs to die so a new culture can emerge. I'm getting that also. And I'm also getting that when women's rage is unleashed, it brings this dignified, pristine clarity in which that shadow melts. The shadow needs to die so it can be part of connection or collaboration with the feminine. And I want to hear more about this, because you said something about this men under, like between each other, have this deal going on that we are not going to leave that behind, what we're standing on. And no one is daring to be the first one to stand outside of that and say, let's not fucking do this anymore. Let's, like, because there's so much investment unconsciously in that.
What is the feeling they have?
Fear. And like,
thank you. So think back. When did you join the patriarchy, Kian?
To me, it feels in my mother's belly. Yeah.
You have zero experience in the world other than as a patriarch. And to cast away all of that is scary. And every single man around you is the same. Hopeless, hopelessly ignorant of the world. Out of touch with the world to that degree. Zero hands-on experience in a world that's not patriarchy. It's terrifying. And it's the way. It is the way. This is the way. I'm glad Anton got the joke.
Yes.
It's a movie quote from The Mandalorian. But it's true sometimes. Laura, are you going to say something?
Yes. I have a question about how it's okay for a woman to abandon all that I learned to do from being in the womb. And I can see that when I'm feeling rage about my strategies and what I'm allowing, that I want something different. I want to create something different. And I have a question about how is that not, can that also be the same for men if they're angry about the, like if they see themselves doing abuse, for example? So there's something I'm missing in this, that it's only women that can build archaiarchy.
You're using the word man very lightly. You're fooling yourself by using the word man. The women's revolution started in the 1960s or 50s, or even when women in America were fighting to be able to vote in 1918 or something. Like that, this is when women's revolution started. The men's revolution has not started yet. You're 100 years ahead of men, whether you know it or not. You're 100 years ahead of men in terms of waking up or becoming what a woman is. So when you use the word man, you might think in your head, well, okay, I've been working on being a woman. Well, obviously they've been working on being a man. So therefore I can talk to a man. You're not talking to a man. You're talking to a hollow shell. It's kind of desperately sad. But if you don't understand that the word man does not exist yet, it does not exist in patriarchy, and it hardly exists in archaearchy, then you'll stop fooling yourself. You will be less naive. So, you know, I don't use the word man. I use crippled being. So it's, I go, hello, crippled being. You know, you've been abused and destroyed in the culture of patriarchy before you were born. So, you know, there's this crippled, uninitiated, collapsed, survival, desperate, mean, you know, egotistical, narcissistic, you know, almost psychopath that you're talking to. And there is no such thing as man. So you, Laura, you're using the word man too lightly, you know, without consideration for reality.
Yeah, I see that, like, when you're speaking, that it's speaking to some, I guess, some sort of fantasy that I'm in, that there is one man out there who will be the exception.
Well, and so you should talk more with Anne Chloe and stuff about this. There's spaces in which this conversation is can be engaged more fully, because it's a big conversation, because there is work for women relating with the crippled being that is in the masculine body. There's work for that. There's ways to work with that. But I would say it's a bigger conversation than this space can hold right now, unless Anne Chloe, you wanted to say something.
No, what I would say is, for example, in this space, we've been together for an hour, and for now, almost only men have spoken. And Laura, when you spoke as a woman, Clinton, could you mute yourself, because we're just too close as a feedback? Thank you. And you spoke as a woman was try to defend the men. And this is very typical, so typical of women in the patriarchy. And so I think that would be part of the conversation I would have in this space in terms of Rage Club spaceholder is, what's going on with the woman? How come? Because you have questions, you have pain, you have, and how come you didn't speak yet? And then, yes, there's a bigger conversation. And just your invitation, Clinton, was, I'm interested to make a work talk. It would be it wouldn't be a work talk. Your discovery, it would be a women's circle about this as it is emerging in the field of possibility management in archaearchy.
I'd like to propose a slightly different understanding of what was happening, that the women were not speaking in this space, which is that there was a chance here for the men to get more naked or get more real or get more present with the real condition that the men are faced with. And the women were, out of integrity and respect, holding space for that. It was what my experience was, that the women were holding space for the men to take a risk here. And so that's how it was looked for me, mostly. I did not feel so much about women not speaking because they didn't have something to say or were too afraid to speak or whatever, that it was a men's space or something. But it was I've been in lots of spaces, and very rarely have I been in spaces with this many men willing to feel and hear what we've been talking about. So I thank the women for holding the space for the men to have this conversation, even with women present. And Anne Chloe, I didn't mean to interrupt you if you were still going to say something.
No, I just want to say I was appreciating the conversation, and I'm still suspicious about the not speaking and the not showing up and the hiding and the somebody else is occupying space. So I wanted to say it.
Thank you. This is open.
I have been sitting with the question, and I think it's related to what you're saying, Laura, of how can I be in your team, men? Because I notice the more I walk, the more I collaborate with women, and I work with women, and I live with women, and I avoid you, and that's something that I'm doing. And so, I know to heal my relationship with you emotionally is something that I can do to be on your team, to work on my sexual energy, to make it conscious. And that's what I've been sitting with. How am I on your team? And also not mothering you, not treating you, continuing to treat you like a baby. And I don't know how else. And I'm I want to discover how to relate in a different way and how to be on your team.
Ian, could I say something first? It's just sure. It's simply one way, and I mentioned it before, but one way is to keep the bar where you want to keep the bar. Hold that bar there and never let it move. Never adapt to take care of or be nice to, or you know, try to connect with at their level. Is to hold the bar here. And if the man can't go there, it's no conversation. And that will force men to go, well, that's something I want to talk to. What do I have to do to get there? And that's amazing gift that you can give for the men, is to hold the bar where it needs to be in archaearchy. And don't submit. Don't release it. Thank you.
Thank you. I feel fear and sadness. And I have the story that then I will relate with no men. Thank you for that.
Well, I challenge you to try it for 6 months.
I accept.
Please report, Maria, okay, about what you see or learn or try or discover. And if you discover other experiments that are useful along those lines, please just write the experiment up, because we'll share it on websites and stuff for other people to try. So it's a research time. Thank you.
Thank you.
And one experiment that you could try also is to unleash your unfiltered disgust and anger towards anything that doesn't fit into that level that you want to connect with. I've had the experience. I met once a woman who was like this with me, when I tried to make a move from my little child or boy or whatever coming close to her, she was just this like screaming at me, unleashed, totally unheld back. Like not like a mad woman, but like a real response to what I was trying to manipulate her with. And that was one of the biggest services I ever received from a woman.
Thank you.
When I started the journey, I think that having a new partner was impossible for me. And now I have a lot to offer to the Archaeacademy with my presence with a man. And I'm so glad for this.
Could you give us some details, Andrea? Some details what you're talking about?
Yes. It's so deeper for me that it's impossible to me stay with another man together and stay a partner. And now I think that's about the last woman, Lab. I think I offer my presence with a man, and we stay with a man. It's building for the Akiyakad. And for me, it's so new, but I have to talk about this in this place for you and Chloe, because for me, it's so, so important to change this in my mind.
Thank you.
Thank you. For you, Maria, also, when you say you want to be on the team of the men, and what I hear also from Andrea is to maintain this certain arrogancy as a woman towards man, and to not mm-hmm. give in and sell you for a lower price. It's also what you said, Clinton, to keep the bar high and know that you can do that, and that's okay.
Because the men cannot do that. So if the women do not do it, it will not be done. It will not happen.
Why men cannot do that? This is my question, because I feel
you can answer that question.
Well,
go ahead.
Well, maybe another context. As a man, I can hold my bar higher to give inspiration or give impulses to aim higher for other men in men's circles or other spaces. I understand it's one of the things that I can do for men. And what I cannot do, what women can do.
Well, you could say, honey, if you don't get this, this conversation is over. If you're going to keep working in the army, if you're going to keep working a corporate job, if you're going to keep doing Bitcoin, if you're going to keep chopping down trees and killing animals and tearing up the blowing up mountains for coal, I'm not sleeping with you ever again. You can't do that. Makes a difference.
Fair point, thank you.
I mean, I would add that even this picture of, you know, the woman says, I'm relating here. And you say, okay, I'm going to kick men's ass to aim higher. But that frame is a patriarchal frame, trying to be, you know, better, more, you know, like try to aim, try to do it good, try to, that is already framed in the patriarchy. And men's work is burning work. It is burning work. And so you didn't say, I'm going to put coals under the fire, you know, under the ass of men. You said, I'm going to teach them how to aim higher. And so that's the prison. It's the circular thinking that's in men's circle, that you're trying to exit the patriarchy with patriarchal thoughtware, and you're just running in circles, something like that. And the other side of, just a short, I think the other side of men's work is the reaction to that is, let's try to be okay with each other. I'm trying to make myself be okay. And I really, is there something in the field in terms of what Clinton, you were saying in the beginning of, there's such big necessity for Rage Club to go consult and to go out there, like to go consult other gay men and to be bold in the offers and the, like the unreasonability, like that it's unreasonable is one of the men who watched the last study group, which I encourage you to watch it as part of this conversation. It's the first time I heard a man say, I'm tired of fake men's work. I'm tired of it. Men come together and it's fake. And I've never heard that before from any men. I've heard that from women also being tired of fake women's work. And so there's a door open, but not with circular patriarchal thoughtware.
You're muted, Clinton.
As a meta conversation, I want to acknowledge that here we are gathered together in the context of a Rage Club spaceholder training. And we're having this conversation about what are, for me, the most important things in the world to be angry about or to change or to look at with clear eyes. And this is an acknowledgement of the maturity of the rage work, that this kind of space you guys are holding space for, has this maturity of anger about the right things. We're not angry about our mother, or angry about not getting enough money at work, or angry about our neighbors, or angry about taxes. You know, this has not been in this space. We're angry about these central issues or central elements that were just angry. It just feels really valuable use of anger and space. And so I don't know who you guys are or how you came together, but I just hope you keep going.
I want to share one more thing that I'm doing work with young boys at the moment.
Ian, can I? I just want to add something from what Clinton just said, which is, and the invitation is make your Rage Club about that, because that's your question. So make the Rage Club about what you are angry about, and that will give people a bigger problem than figuring out how. Yeah, like Clinton said, like deal with their neighbors or deal with their boss. It's like this is not the conversation of Rage Club. With you holding space for it. It could be the conversation in a different Rage Club with different space holders, but not with you. Thank you.
Yeah, you don't have to lower yourself to the ordinary anger, you know, immature, reflect with the reactive anger. You can, because there are other Rage Club space holders, and those people who need that will go to them, but you will attract the people who are ready for this conversation, who are ready to face this with their rage. You know, bring women together to rage, and out of that will come archaearchy. And if you stand there, the world around you will change. So that's the invitation. And I don't even think you need an invitation. I think that's really what's happening.
Thank you, Clinton, for saying that. It seems to be obvious, but sometimes I cannot see something on my own, and what I need is to hear this invitation or this, that there is a possibility. So thank you.
I'll be here for about another 10 minutes if anybody needs anything else from me personally. And I'd like to hear Luciana's voice and maybe Rita.
Hello, Clinton.
Hi.
Hi.
What is it for you, Luciana?
This is new for me, like changing to archaearchy. And I feel fear, like as Anne Chloe said, I feel fear of like trying to build a matriarchy. Can I say that? To raise my bar and then like to keep in the circle. Shifting the genders.
Mm-hmm.
So I think this is very challenging.
Luciana, have you studied the Taurus Technology website?
Not yet.
Please do, because yes. It empowers you to hold space in a different way. Like yes. In culture and patriarchy, there's this word leadership, and it sounds like okay. A good thing. It sounds like you need to try to be a leader.
Okay.
And the thing with leaders is the only way you can be a leader is if there are followers. So you're creating followers, you're creating the hierarchy if you're trying to be in leadership. And so the invitation is to really practice bringing people together in a circle. And it's a completely different orientation of space holding to leadership. Space holding is completely different other thing than leadership. Space holding is calling forth, bringing out, supporting. And it is not about going first, you know, like giving all the ideas or telling people what to do. This is this leadership thing. This is space holding has to do with this rolling, it's the river, it's the evolution, like calling out elements, bringing stuff through people that they don't even know can come through them. And so it's a whole different orientation. So please get good at that. Get unreasonably competent at Taurus technology. So everywhere you go,
Taurus technology.
You are a Taurus. A Taurus is like a circle donut. And it's a circle of circles. It's this living circle of circle space. Just get really good at it.
Yes, perfect. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Give a work talk on it.
Yes.
Several, and start. That's how you learn stuff is teach it to other people. That's how I learn stuff, figure things out. Do you know what a Taurus technology is? No, let's give a work talk on it. And people will ask you questions that you won't know the answers to, and you will learn really fast. Rita, hello.
Hello. I'm scared to talk because I've been through about 3-hour process this morning, clearing the energetic body from drugs.
Whoa.
And I arrived here 15 minutes before the session, and I feel very liquid and strangely high, as if I was on drugs right now. So it's requiring quite a lot of anger to stay present. And I am different to my usual identity, and I notice how difficult it is for me to be in a space being not my usual self.
I hope you get used to it. I hope it becomes your new home.
Can you say something about this process? Where to do it? How do you do that?
I think they're only, it's like a, I think it's a process only to be held by trainers. Correct me if I'm wrong. So specific people know how to hold this process. So I asked someone, Ana Norambuena, to hold this process for a group of people here where I live. So a few of us went through this process a few hours ago. And you clear your energetic body from different substances, from drugs.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. My guess is that it's also a feelings practitioner process. And so it would be feelings practitioner trainers to be holding space for that.
Great. Anything else from anybody else right now?
Like Jacopo?
Yes, I
go ahead, David, but yeah, I wanted to also hear Jacopo.
You muted Jacopo.
Thank you. I feel scared about this conversation that we've been having until now. And really noticing like different parts inside of me, like that are fighting. And there's also a part of me who's not, in a way, is not getting it. It's not getting it, and I'm not giving much attention to that because I also don't want to try to get it. What we are talking about, and it's also very clear to me, like also living with Rita. How she's 100 years ahead of me. And how often I get shown my incompetence of being a man with a woman. I feel sad as I say that. And I don't want to get it. Like I want to be more competent. That's all I want to do. And I have no idea how it looks like. And what I can do is to in a way.
So I have a proposal.
Stop fighting. Go ahead.
I have a proposal. And the proposal is you've got Anton and Carolo. And Kian especially, and David some also, but you've got these men who are getting this. They're working right there. They're working right there. And if two of them would be willing to be in a three cell with you for the next year, and you just go, I don't get it. Tell me the next thing to practice. What I'm missing this. This pisses me off. This scares me. I hate this. And you just tell them this and say, what do I do next? What do I try next? What am I missing? And they could give it for you. You're just lucky these guys are here because these guys have been working their asses off to try to get something. They've had the same question you have. They've just been working on it maybe longer than you. I don't know. But these guys they're getting this conversation, or else we could not have had this conversation. There would have been no place here for that to land except these guys could hear it. So you've got these guys right at your shoulder, but you would need to negotiate a three cell with two of them at least, and then have that and then continue that for about a year. By the end of the year of hard work, ass kicking and trying totally new experiments over and over again, something would unfold in you that you just can't even see right now. That's the proposal.
Thank you. And okay, I'll let it land more. And then there is this fear of like, what is that different from a man's circle? Like in a way, like what I'm saying is that I learn so much from Rita in this case, or from women also about, like I learn from that.
And see these guys are not men's circle guys. If I understood what you just said, that what you're saying is you want some women to coach you. Is that what you're asking for?
No. What I'm saying is that, like, for me, noticing how incompetent I am, that's for me the lesson.
No, it's not the lesson. It's what the fuck are you going to do about it? That's the lesson. What the hell are you going to do different? That's the lesson. It isn't, oh God, I feel the pain of how incompetent I am as a man. That is not it. What's next? What are you going to try? Different and different and different. That's the lesson. You know, so the door's open right now for you to make your 3-cell and you're not going through the door. And I'm leaving. So good luck. I want to thank you all for this really precious conversation for me. And I appreciate the work you're doing. So stay in touch. If you need anything, let me know. Take care.
Thank you.
Thank you, Clinton.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you, Clinton.
Thank you.
Okay.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
Jacopo, will you ask for the 3-cell?
No.
Thank you. What holds you back from asking for the 3-cell?
It is just not living for me right now, the necessity of a 3-cell with men.
Okay.
I mean, how can you say that when you're right in the middle of a liquid state about being incompetent as a man? And that the 3-cell men would be telling you, try this instead, do this instead, notice this instead. It would tell you what to do instead.
And I want to say one more thing. I think you actually, Jacopo, you carry also already something for other men to get that we didn't get.
I think we leave it like this, or
yeah.
I don't want to ask for it now. I let it land. I'm not shutting the door. And I don't want to ask for it now.
Thank you.
Thank you. David and Kian, I know you wanted to say something before. Is it still?
Yes. Yeah? I have a question about how when you are holding space for a space or for a game world, I was like feeling liquid with the question when it's the moment to send out someone. And I think I need to do EHPs around that. And also I was observing like the fear of, okay, if I send out someone because I think that should happen, I'm also like, I'm afraid that maybe I cutting possibilities because just my gremlin is afraid and I don't know how to handle anymore. And that's for a rage club, but also for my community, for example.
Mm-hmm.
Receiving people very often, and yeah, I would like just to hear if you had the experience before and how it's for you.
So I think different people could say different thing. I want to give you some context about that. So in terms of, it would be different for a community than for a rage club, and I will speak to the community first, which is, If you have one person like you being the person who decides who stays and who goes, then you're like the executioner. Because if somebody leaves the community, then you basically say you go die outside in the wood. And that's how we have it wired in ourselves. And so to have that job is the most horrible job to have. So it actually doesn't really work because you have a big heart. You know, people in community usually have a big heart, and it's like, I can't do this. I can't do this to people. So it might be worth also checking out for emotional healing processes of, you know, have you in past life ever kicked people out and they died, or you've been kicked out and made decisions about that? Or so it's worth checking out with an EHP. And really what we found has worked is this amoeba method. So I think we've mentioned it, you know, when we came to in Lakesh about this amoeba is this one cell organism that eats what it needs to live, like to be nourished, and then like pushes out what it's not feeding it. And the amoeba is the community at large. It's the group intelligence. You know, I don't really use the word collective, but you could say it as a collective of like, okay, it makes sense. This person is in. They've been hanging around, you know, participating in workshops, helping up with the garden, taking care of the kids, being in the truck. Yeah, they're in the community. Of course, they're in Lakesh. And it's the exact same process for the exit strategy. However, it needs to be really clear in your codex that the entry, like the entry is the amoeba and the exit is the amoeba. And you just say, because if you don't have an exit strategy, then you have a bottleneck. People come in and don't leave. And then you have energies that don't feed the community, the game world, the organization, the team, and actually suck the energy out. And it's time for them to actually go do something else with their life. And it's like, in a way, it's like, it's a life-saving thing. And so I've been that person in terms of the game world of the trainer path in possibility management, having this conversation of the amoeba, you're not feeding the amoeba. And what has happened is the liberation of people's archetypal lineage in what they truly were, because they weren't trainers. And you know, years later, people come and write me a message and say, Anclay, thank you for having this terrible conversation of, you know, at the time felt so horrible that I needed to leave, because now I can be myself instead of trying to pretend to be, a, you know, an expand the box trainer or an in Lakesha or something like that. So, you know, and a lot for example, in Lakesh, the amoeba will be a lot the infinity ring. The infinity ring gets a sense of the context, the purpose, what's needed. What's needed to feed so that the game world, the team, the people are fed. This is about nourishment. Yet it's not about family. It's not about friends. It's about nourishment of this place that is a seed crystal for archaearchy. It's worth protecting. It's worth guarding. So that's one thing. For a rage club, there's a, in the previous, I think it was just the previous rage club spaceholder training, it would have been, it's right at the beginning of the call. So you can listen, you can watch the recording. It would have been session 2, 3, or 4, like in the middle, where I asked somebody to leave the rage club spaceholder training. And at this point, that responsibility lands on me as the spaceholder. And I want to share a few things, which is, if you have this idea of there's always, you know, there's the last guy in a training, there's always the last person, you know, who doesn't get it, who's kind of don't participate, doesn't talk, and you just like, God, what are they doing here? So this is the last guy thing. Like, or it can be a last woman, but last person syndrome. And if you say, okay, they're not getting it, I'm kicking them out. Well, then you have the next last person. And if you kick them out, you know, the next last person, what you left with is yourself. That's the only person left if you keep kicking the last person. So you want to include the last person as part of the tribe. And so my compass in terms of having somebody for me to ask them to leave is, are they destroying the space? Is there gremlin destroying the space? That means in breakout rooms, in groups of three, in three cells, they're scaring people. They're attacking people. And people who don't, you know, basically the people who come to my space, they come because my gremlin can handle their gremlin. But in a breakout room, you don't know who you're going to be. You're going to have gremlins that are bigger than your gremlin. And so it's my job to keep protecting, you know, people from other people's unconscious gremlin. That's my job, because they came from my gremlin. And the if they're destroying the space, and the second condition is if they're unwilling to do anything about it. So, and you see, that's the conversation I'm having with this men is, do you see, you know, there's this example and this example and this example, anything about that? And he says, I don't even know what you're talking about. I say, okay. And I open more than three doors, I think. I open more than three doors. And it was unwilling to notice, God, yeah, my gremlin is up to something. And I said, okay, we can't work. Then we can't work. And I give him all his money back, you know, out of the group, all his money back. No, you know, the money thing is, don't keep the money. Do not, if you kick somebody out, give them their money back. Because otherwise it's like, then you're playing both games. And it's not, you know, forget it.
Mm.
Does that help?
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, the distinction of when somebody is destroying the space, that helps to me.
Yeah, it can, and it check out, you know, it's like that. It's also not, you know, a person could be demanding that you bring as big, you know, you bring your gremlin as big as it really is. You know, it's like, hey, I signed up because your gremlin is actually that big. And so, okay, handle me, you know. So it would, the thing about destroying the space is, if you're handling the gremlin, you know, if you can be so clear and sharp and you're holding space for the gremlin, but they're unwilling to transform. That's what I mean by destroying the space. But you need to be impeccable in your stand with them, that you actually can hold space for their gremlin. And you assume that because they've signed up to your space.
Mm.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you. Does somebody have anything else to add in terms of what you've experienced? Yeah.
Yes. Yes. I want to add that it's about clarifying what are you a yes to and what are you a no to in the space, and then voicing it. And then what you're a no to, that's how it becomes not personal. It's not that your gremlin doesn't like that person. It's that what that person is bringing, it's not, the space is not for that.
So Marie, then, I would frame it just a little bit different, because the way you frame it about what you are yes or no to, then it's fanatical. Then it's a religion of David. You know, it's religion. This is appropriate and this is not appropriate. And I decide because I'm the space holder. And to frame it in terms of the yes or the no, it's more, which culture is this rage club taking place in? So then immediately you're having this meta conversation of, then you live in a different culture than I'm living, and your culture doesn't function here. It's a little bit different than this, you know, the space holder says yes or no. It's this meta conversation of saying, I'm holding space for a particular culture, and there's some values, behaviors, awarenesses, distinction that makes this culture thrive, and that's what I'm going to stand for.
Yes.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Cool.
Yes, it's not about me or about you.
Right. Ian, are you going to say something? Okay. So I had an idea of maybe doing a practice. At the same time, I think the space was really rich and I wouldn't want to shift it into a practice space. So I would propose to end in maximum 15 minutes. So on top of the hour. And I just want to, open a space of what, anything that you want to say in need or as to complete this chapter and this teamwork. And I want to say a couple of things that I said yesterday is, one, I would like the group to keep going for another 2 or 3 weeks so that we can keep working on the challenges. And because everybody's been doing different challenges from different weeks, and I love that. You know, it's like, where am I? What's needed for me at this point? And I made this invitation also last night, but I would really emphasize doing this, appreciating the quality of space holding of other people, because that's things we can put on our website. You take out, that's a review for you, and you put it in your website. People get a sense of, this is what I can experience being with this person. So it's really a service for each other to do that. And yeah, and I'll open the, as Clinton said, I will open the bridge to the Rachel space holder, the bigger group. And then I think more and more of our conversation can then shift into the bigger group. And this question from Clinton, it's like, you know, the place, the way to be a team is to have this break in certainty together. And so how to bring ourselves, you know, into the bigger group of people so that we actually become a team is to be in a liquid state. And I might think about that, or, you know, bring a call together. I don't know if 100 people will be able to make it, but that there's some cross-pollination between people who've been, and some people have been delivering Rage Club for years and have just great stories and great legends. And, you know, and some people have only delivered one Rage Club and then didn't make use of the team to keep jacking back in into the source, like to come back into the space being, this exists, like Rage Club exists. And that could be a chance maybe for them to come back in as an invitation. So I'll think about that. But anything from you, anything you want to say or complete or...
I want to appreciate the time of this Rage Club in specific, because when I heard before that we are creating, or we are walking together into this new culture, archy, it was this totally foreign concept. It was this out there thing that is something, but I have no idea what it is. And it would be a lie to say that I'm creating that, or that I'm a stand for that. And, or just an idea, just a belief, some kind of story that I tell myself or tell others to sound cool. And this is the first Rage Club that or the first Rage Club spaceholder training in which I'm getting what that means. I'm getting that there's actually a thing happening, that there's actually the emergence of a new culture happening on the planet, and we are part of that. And it's a felt energetic space that can be inhabited, that is. And what touches me about this, or where I feel this deep grief, is in which I, as a man, get to have a like live, but not only like as a, that's me personally, but yeah, in which humanity can live. But, and I'm really, I feel this. Okay, maybe it's not, I want to do a do-over, in which I, like in the beginning, I felt like I lose so much by participating in that. I lose all these gremlin powers that I thought would keep me as something. And so it didn't seem like an invitation to that appeals, but now I'm getting that I get to live in that new culture.
Thank you, Kian.
Thank you, Kim.
Thank you.
If that's it, that's it. But Rita, you moved. Hold on, Rita.
Yes, I did. I'm scared of speaking when my energetic body is slow and somehow high. And yeah, these Rage Club space holder training sessions we've had, my fear has been high. Like it's a scary space for me to be in. And I love it. And as I was scared, I have also been like inside me, like, yeah, there's something in throughout the day after Rage Club space holder training, I feel so alive, and there is so much joy also running through my system. And yeah, I love being in this space.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Rita.
I want to say that I feel sadness. I felt sadness when I realized that I missed the first last week meeting yesterday. And this was because I was on a training on in a different lineage, and I felt like I lost something, like I'm not participating enough, or I'm not paying attention enough. And it was heartbreaking for a moment. And then I realized there is a chance, there is still, I need to wake up at like before 2 a.m. and I can be with you guys, and I feel joy as well in the same time that I'm here with you. There was this struggle in me about Rage Club because of the Buddhist background, but during the Rage Club, the spaceholder training, I was able to address these doubts and different approaches and to find common ground. And I'm grateful for that. I'm grateful that I'm here with you. And now I feel fear. Fear of saying something stupid or inappropriate. But in the end, I really thank you guys for being you, actually, for the support, for words, for feedback and coaching, and for the natural process, whatever I can call it, for this being authentic. Thank you.
Thank you, Carol.
Thank you, Carol.
Thank you.
Thank you, Carol.
I want to say something. I want to thank you and Chloe. It was really important for me, this training, to build inner matrix. And I feel fear of being the last person. And I feel fear that I'm not prepared to be like Rage Club space holder yet. But yes.
Yeah, thank you, Luciana. I mean, so keep going. Keep going. And there's a Brazilian team, you know, Brazilian team, call your Brazilian team. And, you know, like that, there's more Rage Club space holders in Brazil that are waiting to be born. And I like you, you know, at this place of, I want to do it. I'm not sure I can. Come together, do, yes, Rage Club together, do, you know, emotional healing processes together. Because that's, a lot of people, this was their second time to do the Rage Club space holder training. It's worth, mm-hmm, to do it, you know, a second time. And to do it in your local country, in your local language, will also be a different experience for you. Yes. You know, your own language. So this is go all around. Great. Yeah.
Thank you, Luciana.
Yeah, thank you, Luciana.
Thank you.
I feel a lot of fear about being on this team. And I notice where I kind of keep myself on the edge. And I have this, it's so scary to be here and to really see what's been asked of me. Or what's been asked of me in this training. And I'm holding back saying that. And now that I'm just saying that and feeling the fear, I feel more this exhilaration and this joy also about being on this team. And just a lot of energy. And I held back. I definitely held back. And yeah, I also showed up, and I feel the joy about that. And thank you, Aunt Chloe. Yeah. Thank you, team.
Thank you, Laura.
Thank you, Laura.
Thank you, Laura.
Thank you.
Well, I don't know if you do this, but you know, we've met about, I think it was about a year ago, right? We met about a year ago. And who you were a year ago and who you are today is like universes apart. And so you have there's another few universes to go into, and it will be more and more exhilarating.
Yes, yes. Thank you.
Cool.
I somehow want to speak to this, that this is, Anklo, your last Rage Club Space Holder training, and with that goes the legacy ends of you holding space for that. And I just feel really, I want to honor that. I want to celebrate what you've brought into the world and what you've made hundreds of people walk into. And yeah, I don't know. I think you can, yeah, somehow Gaia, I don't even dare to speak for Gaia, but I have the sense that Gaia is so, so grateful for what you've created. Thank you for that.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, I feel sad when you say that about that. That's a chapter for me. It's a chapter that I decided to close, and it's been, and it's not like a closed door for Evan, locked and throw the key, but it's still the end of a chapter. And I still remember, I wish that I had recorded the first ever Rage Club Space Holder training session. I remember I was in the Canary Islands in La Gomera, and I had 80% fear for like a whole day before. I thought, I can't do this. It was just so terrifying. And I remember I log on, and then it was 2.5 hours, and I log off, and I'm like, what happened? Where was I for 2.5 hours? And yeah, and since then, it's just been this, really this one, like, wonderful and liquid state and enraging and really scary and so much connection, this journey. And so thank you, Kian, for opening the door for me to also say, in a way, like, we'll close it. Yeah. Thank you. Okay. Anything else?
I want to share that this training was the first training that I actually went willing to be in this training. So many times I found myself being in a training because I thought I had to be there. So I was pressuring myself into the trainings, and this time I was actually like really thirsty for the training. And I discovered that I can go just take a risk and not knowing how to do any exercise and just doing it. And yeah, and I discovered that even though I don't know and I might do it wrong, I still don't die. And this was great for me.
Die without dying.
Yeah, parts of me died, definitely.
Okay, we meet each other in other spaces, and I'll send out a bunch of links and everything. But thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Uncle.
Love
thank
to everybody. All of you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye.
Bye.